Blessed be God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
And blessed be His kingdom, now and forever. Amen.
Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. Hear what our Lord Jesus Christ says. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with your soul, and mind. This is the first and great commandment, and the second is like it. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. On these two commandments depend all the law and the prophets.
Lord, have mercy upon us.
Christ, have mercy upon us.
Lord, have mercy upon us. Glory be to God on high.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Let us pray. O God, you know that we are set in the midst of many grave dangers, and because of the frailty of our nature, we cannot always stand upright. Grant that your strength and protection may support us in all dangers and carry us through every temptation. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. Amen.
A reading from the book of Deuteronomy. The Lord your God will raise up for you a prophet like me from among you, from your brothers. It is to him that you shall listen, just as you desired of the Lord your God at Horeb on the day of the assembly, when you said, "Let me not hear again the voice of the Lord my God, or see this great fire anymore, lest I die." And the Lord said to me, they are right in what they have spoken. I will raise up for them a prophet like you from among their brothers. And I will put my words in his mouth, and he shall speak to them all that I command him. And whoever will not listen to my words that he shall speak in my name, I myself will require it of him. But the prophet who presumes to speak a word in my name that I have not commanded him to speak, or who speaks in the name of other gods, that same prophet shall die. And if you say in your heart, how may we know the word which the Lord has not spoken? When a prophet speaks in the name of the Lord, if the word does not come to pass or come true, that is a word the Lord has not spoken. The prophet has spoken it presumptuously. You need not be afraid of him. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
A reading from Paul's first epistle to the Corinthians. Now concerning food offered to idols, we know that all of us possess knowledge. This knowledge puffs up, but love builds up. If anyone imagines that he knows something, he does not yet know as he ought to know. But if anyone loves God, he is known by God. Therefore, as to the eating of food offered to idols, we know that an idol has no real existence, and that there is no God but one. For although there may be so-called gods in heaven or on earth, as indeed there are many gods and many lords, yet for us there is one God, the Father, from whom are all things and for whom we exist, and one Lord Jesus Christ, through whom are all things and through whom we exist. However, not all possess this knowledge, but some, through former association with idols, eat food as really offered to an idol, and their conscience, being weak, is defiled. Food will not commend us to God. We are no worse off if we do not eat, and no better off if we do. But take care that this right of yours does not somehow become a stumbling block to the weak. For if anyone sees you, who have knowledge, eating in an idol's temple, will he not be encouraged, if his conscience is weak, to eat food offered to idols? And so by your knowledge this weak person is destroyed, the brother for whom Christ died. Thus, sinning against your brothers and wounding their conscience when it is weak, you sin against Christ. Therefore, if food makes my brother stumble, I will never eat meat, lest I make my brother stumble. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
He entered the synagogue and was teaching, and they were astonished at his teaching, for he taught as one who had authority and not as the scribes. And immediately there was in their synagogue a man with an unclean spirit, and he cried out, "What have you to do with us, Jesus of Nazareth? Have you come to destroy us? I know who you are, the Holy One of God." But Jesus rebuked him, saying, "Be silent, come out of him." And the unclean spirit convulsed him, and crying out with a loud voice, came out of him. And they were all amazed, so they questioned among themselves, saying, "What is this? A new teaching with authority? He commands even the unclean spirits, and they obey him." And at once his fame spread everywhere, but all the surrounding region of Galilee. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost. Amen. Amen. You may be seated. Well, today is a special Sunday in the liturgical calendar, or at least the old ones. Today is what used to be called Septuagesma Sunday. And all of you say Septuagesima. Bless you. No, Septuagesima is not a sneeze. What it is it's sort of a countdown to Lent. The Gesimas, there are three of them, count down the Sundays to Lent. And that means that you've got this Sunday, next Sunday, and the Sunday after. And then Ash Wednesday will be upon us on February 14th. Yes, I complained to God that he put Ash Wednesday on top of Valentine's Day this year, but he didn't listen. So, fellas, we're all in trouble this year. But Septuagesima Sunday has always been one of my favorites because I find that this countdown is a really important time. What it does is it enables us to begin to prepare ourselves for the coming of Ash Wednesday. And if we're to take Ash Wednesday and all of Lent seriously, then Septuagesima is very important. Because this is the time at which we should begin looking at ourselves and thinking to ourselves, what types of disciplines will I take up this Lent in order to prepare myself for an excellent Easter? Well, I think that this little verse that we have for us today, the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom, can be very helpful for us. Because it will require wisdom to know what disciplines to pick up. It will require wisdom to know how to use them properly. It will require wisdom to be able to develop virtue on the other end of it. And so today I want to look at this brief little verse that we all know so well. I want to examine, first of all, the value of wisdom. Second of all, how it is cultivated in the fear of the Lord. And then finally, the centrality of the experience of God in that cultivation. But first, my first task is one that seems to me obvious. And it's to demonstrate to you the value, nay, the necessity of wisdom. I don't understand why we would have to demonstrate such a thing. It seems obvious that wisdom is necessary. But I fear that the way that we tend to understand wisdom really undermines its true value. I think most of us would think of wisdom as expressing the ability to see the world as it truly is and to apply that knowledge in such a way as to reap the greatest benefits that the world has to offer. But I fear that when we hear this definition of wisdom, that we tend to end up in a place of merely worldly wisdom. That it's a wisdom that can only help us in this life and to gain the things of this world as we understand it. No, I think that wisdom is far more than that. As a matter of fact, another word for wisdom is prudence. And prudence is the first of the four cardinal virtues. Prudence, justice, temperance, and fortitude. This word cardinal in Latin means hinge. These are called the hinge virtues because these four particular virtues are so important that on these four virtues, all other virtues hinge as a door on a hinge. And not only that, but prudence is the first of these, which makes wisdom the virtue by which we gain all other virtues, the door by which we enter into the godly life. And without it, there can be no growth in the Christian life. But then again, I think that wisdom is even more than that for us. Indeed, I would suggest to you that wisdom is Christ himself. Proverbs chapter 8, verse 22 begins to tell us this. Speaks of wisdom in this way. The Lord possessed me at the beginning of his work, the first of his acts of old. Ages ago I was set up at the first, before the beginning of the earth, when there were no depths I was brought forth, when there were no springs abounding with water, before the mountains had been shaped and before the hills I was brought forth, before he had made the earth with its fields or the first of the dust of the world, when he established the heavens I was there. When he drew a circle of the face of the deep, when he made firm the skies above, when he established the fountains of the deep, when he assigned to the sea its limit so that the waters might not transgress his command, when he commanded out the foundations of the earth, then I was beside him. I was a master workman, and I was daily his delight. rejoicing before him, always rejoicing in his inhabited world and delighting in the children of man. That sounds an awful lot like what St. John tells us in his first chapter of his gospel. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. All things were made through him, and without him was not anything made that was made. In him was life, and the life was the life of men. Wisdom, my friends, is indispensable, because it's not only the means by which we live a better life, it is not only the means by which we grow in Christian life and Christian virtue, but it is indeed Christ himself enfleshed and come to visit us. Wisdom is the logos of God. Wisdom is both the substance and means as well as the end of the Christian life. And without it, there could be no progress or growth. In short, it is indispensable. And so, my friends, now that we understand the value of wisdom, it would seem that it is indeed indispensable, but also, I fear, in short supply, as is often the case with wisdom. And so we have to now ask ourselves this question: if it is so indispensable, then how can we obtain it and begin to cultivate this indispensable virtue in our lives? Well, the psalm for today tells us. It says, the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. And immediately we begin to trip up on this word fear. And trip we always do. Because our first reaction, of course, is fear. Well, should I be afraid of God? And how on earth can being afraid of God help me to gain wisdom? And often the response to this is that, oh, well, back then the word fear didn't really mean fear. It meant more of a respect, that we should respect the Lord. And I would caution you on both sides, because I think that both of those are wrong. I don't think that either one fully exhibits what the fear of the Lord truly is to be. On one side, we have afraid. And when we think of afraid, we think of the rabbit that's trying to get away from the wolf, that sort of fear. On the other side, if we just think of a sense of respect, then that significantly diminishes the experience that I think it is supposed to show. No, I think the closest we can come to understanding this fear of the Lord in this life is for those of us who have maybe walked away from a close encounter with death. I've had this experience a number of times in my life. One particular one comes to mind. I was at a music festival once, and we were up on a hill. It rained like a whole 4 days. It was an absolute muddy mess. But I was walking along the top of this hill, and suddenly, not more than 20 feet away from me, boom, lightning crashes. So close that you could feel the crack in your soul. It was an experience of being so close to something that could have so devastated my very existence that your mouth turns to sawdust and your knees turn to jelly. One of those experiences where your life flashes before your eyes. In that moment, I didn't have time to be afraid like a rabbit. No, rather, I came to the realization of how frail I was before something so much more powerful and greater. My friends, that is what the fear of the Lord is like. Coming to a full realization of his greatness and our littleness. We see similar examples of this in the scriptures. Isaiah chapter 6, verses 1 through 5 speaks of Isaiah's experience of this. He says, in the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord sitting upon a throne, high and lifted up, and the train of his robe filled the temple. Above him stood seraphim, each had 6 wings. With 2 he covered his face, with 2 he covered his feet, and with 2 he flew. And the one called to the other, holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. The whole earth is full of his glory. And the foundations of the thresholds shook at the voice of him who called, and the house was filled with smoke. And I said, woe is me, for I am lost, for I am a man of unclean lips, and I dwell in the midst of a people of unclean lips, for my eyes have seen the Lord of hosts. It was in this moment that Isaiah first experienced the true fear of the Lord. This text points to the fact that the fear of the Lord is not something that you can just will yourself to have. Rather, it is the natural product of a true experience of the divine, an experience in which the veil is taken away and we see a glimpse of his glory. When we realize that even a little taste is more than we can handle, and also all we could ever really want at the same time. A dessert so sweet that you can't even take another piece, but you know that you will never again taste something so exquisite. In these moments, all of life comes into view and makes perfect sense. It is in these experiences that wisdom is made. The beginning of wisdom is the fear of the Lord. And so, my friends, we understand that wisdom is the indispensable substance of the Christian life. Wisdom only comes from the fear of the Lord, and the fear of the Lord only comes from the experience of God. And this brings us back, full circle, to Septuagesima Sunday. Lent is a time for Christian progress and virtue, and today we begin to count down the days to its beginning. So what will you do to cultivate a true experience of God in your life? In many ways, the Christian liturgy is set up specifically to help us to cultivate this sense of God's presence. Here we come into this beautiful place with choir singing and incense wafting, surrounded by beauty and symbols. We hear the words of the holy angels, "Holy, holy, holy, Lord God of hosts," as heaven descends to earth. The liturgy indeed can bring us before his presence. But it won't just happen for the sake of happening. I think that we have to put something of ourselves into it. We have to have some anticipation or expectation or desire of it. It's something that we have to seek day in and day out. Something that we have to seek at home in our prayer closets. Something we have to seek every time we open the scriptures. We have to push back and fight against our spiritual lives simply becoming mundane and normal and typical. We must ask God to pull back the veil so that we can see him in his full glory, as Moses asked him in the desert. And by this we should take courage, because in James chapter 1, James tells us that if any of you lacks wisdom, let him ask God, who gives generously to all without reproach, and it will be given him. But when you ask this, understand this one thing. You are not asking for wisdom alone, but you are asking for Jesus Christ. An experience of Jesus that will leave you with wobbly legs. An experience that will leave you with a sense of his inestimable power. An experience that will leave you wondering if you are still all in one piece. An experience that will leave you knowing beyond the shadow of a doubt that he is the one true joy of this life and the next. For the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost.
Let us confess our faith in the words of the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is visible and invisible. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate from the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and was made man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come.
This morning, I bid your prayers to the Archbishop and the rest of the ACNA as we pray for a peaceful end to the wars in Israel, Sudan, and Ukraine, and for the protection of civilians on both sides of the conflict. We pray for Father Brian and Deacon Joshua and the work they're doing to reach the community of Brookline, New Hampshire. We pray for those in our parish family currently in physical or spiritual need. Pat Beckwith, Ken Buck, Terry Cullen, Andy French, Sharon Gavoni, Mark Hanchett, Lillian Harper, David Ketchum, Caleb Laurie, Harriet McDougall, Lori Macy, Carolyn O'Brien, Jan Pendleton, Jude Pitlack, Dolly Reed, Kathy Ricquier, and Betty Weisskopf. Let us pray for the church and for the world.
Almighty and ever-living God, we are taught by your holy word to offer prayers and supplications and to give thanks for all people. We humbly ask you mercifully to receive our prayers. Inspire continually the universal church with the spirit of truth, unity, and concord, and grant that all who confess your holy name may agree in the truth of your holy word and live in unity and godly love. Lord, in your mercy, we pray that you will lead the nations of the world in the way of righteousness and so guide and direct their leaders, especially Joe Biden, our president, that your people may enjoy the blessings of freedom and peace. Grant that our leaders may impartially administer justice, uphold integrity and truth, restrain wickedness and vice, and protect true religion and virtue. Lord, in your mercy, give grace, Heavenly Father, to all bishops, priests, and deacons, and especially to your servants, Foley Beach, our Archbishop, and Andrew Williams, our Bishop, that by their life and teaching, they may proclaim your true and life-giving word and rightly and duly administer your holy sacraments. And to all your people, give your heavenly grace, especially to this congregation, that with reverent and obedient hearts we may hear and receive your holy word and serve you in holiness and righteousness all the days of our lives. Lord, in your mercy, prosper, we pray, all those who proclaim the gospel of your kingdom throughout the world, and strengthen us to fulfill your great commission, making disciples of all nations, baptizing them and teaching them to obey all that you have commanded. Lord, in your mercy, we ask you in your goodness, O Lord, to comfort and sustain all who in this transitory life are in trouble, sorrow, need, sickness, or any other adversity. Lord, in your mercy, We remember before you all your servants who have departed this life in your faith and fear, that your will for them may be fulfilled. And we ask you to give us grace to follow the good examples of all your saints, that we may share with them in your heavenly kingdom. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer. Heavenly Father, grant these our prayers for the sake of Jesus Christ, our only mediator and advocate, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen. All who truly and earnestly repent of your sins and seek to live in love and charity with your neighbors and intend to lead the new life, following the commandments of God, and walking in his holy ways, draw near with faith and make your humble confession to Almighty God.
Sins and offenses which we have committed in heart, word, and deed against your divine majesty. For only those trust in your righteous name and offense. We are deeply sorry for these our transgressions. The burden of them is more than we can bear. Have mercy upon us. Have mercy upon us, most merciful Father. For your Son's and Lord Jesus Christ's sake, forgive us all that is past, and grant that we may evermore serve and please you in newness of life, to the honor and glory of your name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, who in his great mercy has promised forgiveness of sins to all those who sincerely repent and with true faith turn to him, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and bring you to everlasting life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Hear the word of God to all who truly turn to him. The saying is trustworthy and deserving of full acceptance that Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners. Please rise. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And with your spirit.
Peace be with you. Well, we welcome all of you here today. If you are visiting, we would like to invite you to fill out a welcome card and to place it in the offering plate as it comes by. God bless you all. Yours, O Lord, is the greatness and the power and the glory and the victory and the majesty, for everything in heaven on earth is yours. Yours is the kingdom, O Lord, and you are exalted as head above all. All things come from you, O Lord. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give him thanks and praise.
It is right, our duty and our joy, always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who took on our mortal flesh to reveal his glory, and that he might bring us out of darkness and into his own glorious light. Therefore we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels and all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. All praise and glory is yours, O God, our Heavenly Father, for in your tender mercies you gave your only Son, Jesus Christ, to suffer death upon the cross for our redemption. He made there, by his one oblation of himself once offered, a full, perfect, and sufficient sacrifice and satisfaction for the sins of the whole world. And he instituted and in his holy gospel commanded us to continue a perpetual memory of his precious death and sacrifice until his coming again. So now, O merciful Father, in your great goodness, we ask you to bless and to sanctify with your word and Holy Spirit these gifts of bread and wine, that we, receiving them according to your Son, our Jesus Christ's holy institution, in remembrance of his death and passion, we may be made partakers of his most precious body and blood. For on the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Likewise, after Jesus took the cup, when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink this, all of you, for this is my body, this is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many, for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this in remembrance of me." Therefore, O Lord and Heavenly Father, according to the institution of your dearly beloved Son, our Savior Jesus Christ, we, your humble servants, celebrate and make here before your divine majesty, with these holy gifts, the memorial your Son commanded us to make, remembering his blessed passion and precious death, his mighty resurrection and glorious ascension, and his promise to come again. And we earnestly desire your fatherly goodness mercifully to accept this, our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving, asking you to grant that by the merits and death of your Son, Jesus Christ, through faith in his blood, we and your whole church may obtain forgiveness of our sins and all other benefits of his passion. And here we offer and present to you, O Lord, ourselves, our souls and bodies, to be a reasonable, holy, and living sacrifice. We humbly pray that all who partake of this holy communion may worthily receive the most precious body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ, be filled with your grace and heavenly benediction, and be made one body with him, that he may dwell in us, and we in him. And though we are unworthy because of our many sins to offer you any sacrifice, we ask you to accept this duty and service we owe, not weighing our merits, but pardoning our offenses, through Jesus Christ, our Lord. In him and with him and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, O mighty Father, now and forever. Amen. And now, as the Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Alleluia. Christ our Passover is sacrificed for us.
Therefore, let us be the peace. Alleluia.
We do not presume to come to this your table, O merciful Lord, trusting in our own righteousness, but in your abundant and great mercy. We are not worthy so much as to gather up the crumbs under your table, but you are the same Lord, whose character is always to have mercy. Grant us, therefore, gracious Lord, to eat the flesh of your dear Son, Jesus Christ, and to drink his blood, that our sinful bodies may be made clean by his body, and our sins washed by his precious blood, and that we may evermore dwell in him, and he in us. Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those who are invited to the marriage supper of the Lamb. Let us pray. Almighty and ever-living God, we thank you for feeding us in these holy mysteries with the spiritual food of the most precious body and blood of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and for assuring us through this sacrament of your favor and goodness towards us, that we are true members of the mystical body of your Son, the blessed company of all faithful people, and are also heirs through hope of your everlasting kingdom. We humbly ask you, Heavenly Father, to assist us with your grace, that we may continue in that holy fellowship and do all good that you prepared for us to walk in, through Jesus Christ our Lord, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit be all honor and glory, now and forever. Amen. The peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ our Lord, and the blessing of God the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always.
Amen.
Go in peace to love and serve the Lord.